Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Brad Harbison from PCT Magazine. I want to thank you for joining us for today's webinar about the Trelona annual bait stations presented by BASF. During the next hour, we're really happy to have you with us to learn a little bit about the latest termite protection product from BASF. Our presenters today are Antonia Chan, Product Manager at BASF Professional and Specialty Solutions, and Dr. Bob Davis, Technical Services Representative for BASF Professional and Specialty Solutions. One quick note to pass along before we get started. We encourage everyone to ask their questions to our speakers throughout the webinar. You can do so by typing them into the question box in the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. However, we will hold all questions until the end so that our presenters have enough time to finish. And with that, I'm going to turn things over to Antonia.
Thanks, Brad. My name is Antonia Chan, and thanks to all of you and PCT for having myself, as well as Dr. Bob Davis, on the phone today on this lovely Valentine's Day to bring to you Trelona ATBS annual bait stations. As Brad said, over the next hour, we plan to provide this overview of our newest product in BASF's strong portfolio of termite baiting, which is Trelona ATBS Advanced Termite Baiting System. What you should expect to take away today is how your operation will benefit from offering Trelona ATBS and how it is a proven termite baiting solution for you as the pest professional. Dr. Bob will take us through the label training as well as best practices for installation and servicing of Trelona Advanced Termite Bait System. So let's get started. First, you know BASF for our dedication to innovations that support solutions for the entire pest control industry. BASF spends about $2 million a day towards research and development of solutions just like Termidor as well as Trelona. Since the early 2000s, we have provided innovations to support the total termite solution in both liquid termiticides like Termidor as well as Phantom, and termite baiting systems like Trelona ATBS. These termite innovations have helped you address many of your changing concerns. We focused on improving the efficiency of a termite job in response to growing labor concerns. You've also seen innovations in products and services to help increase your customers' retention rates. And all this while you remain confident that the products that you are using are the most effective at termite control. In termite baiting alone, we have had several innovations throughout the years, as you can see on this slide, and it has built up a robust and trusted portfolio of termite baiting products. This Trelona Advanced Termite Bait System portfolio is a complete portfolio that offers you both monitoring as well as direct baiting products to support your service offerings. All of these products are, of course, available through the distribution channel. So on the left side of your screen, you see that BASF is committed to support monitoring products with two offerings, the Advanced Termite Bait Stations as well as the Home Monitoring Kit. For both of these products, the stations are installed and inspected at regular intervals until termites are discovered, and then active bait is then placed in to treat when needed. In our portfolio, there are also direct baiting options, and that's shown to the right, where the stations are preloaded and active from the first day of installation. There are two options here. There's direct bait stations, which we introduced in 2014 with a 3 times a year inspection interval, and our newest annual bait stations with the new annual label. Just a note, the direct bait stations are stocked at distribution and will be available only while supplies last. So once this direct bait station product sells out, we will only have the newest annual bait stations to support your direct baiting needs. So let's talk about this newest product. Here is a picture of a case of annual bait stations. These stations are ready to go for annual inspection. In this case, pictured here, there are 16 stations. Each are preloaded with two Trelona bait cartridges ready for annual inspection. When installed at 15 feet spacing, one case can protect a 240 linear foot structure. The case has an agency price of $299 a case and is now stocked and available at your authorized BASF distributors. So with this case, pest professionals like you are only required to inspect the stations annually instead of three times a year or four times a year. And during the annual inspection, professionals maintain the stations by using the Trelona compressed termite bait cartridges that are also available for purchase through distribution. So let's take a look at a financial scenario that you may experience when treating a home. In this cost scenario, we're looking at the cost to install and the cost to maintain stations around a 240 linear foot structure. During the first year, one case of 16 stations will be enough to treat a home of that size, 240 linear feet. And if you're treating a smaller home, less stations would be required. Then during years 2 through 5 in this scenario for that home, Trelona bait is used to maintain the stations. Based on our observed in-field replacement rates, it's expected that an average of 25% of stations would need maintenance bait each year, which comes to a maintenance bait cost on average of about $56 a year. So over 5 years for this large size home, the cost to own the system around that home is competitive with industry averages. Now, over the next few slides, we'll discuss the key benefits of Trelona ATBS annual bait stations. It's high time for the termite industry to get ready for this changing of the guard. So the first benefit is that there is no compromise to your services by having the annual inspection interval, only time savings. The second benefit is that you are in control by fully owning the Trelona ATBS station. And the third benefit is that you are using a trusted system with proven performance, all due to superior station design. So using Trelona ATBS annual bait stations, your operation can optimize the labor for termite baiting services. In this example, we're showing labor inputs expected for the first year of installation, as well as year 2 and year 3 for inspection. Here, I'm assuming $50 an hour for labor. Of course, this may be different than what your company experiences. And we calculate a 3-year labor cost to be $100 a home. And when we compare it to a home that's using a bait system that requires 3 inspections a year, this means a 2.5 times savings over those 3 years. The bottom line, what this means as technicians, because you need to only check those stations once a year, you can service more customers in less time. And as business owners, you can optimize your labor costs. So with Trelona ATBS, you don't have to compromise. Pest professionals also have greater control of their business by owning Trelona ATBS. So when we compare to the leading competitor where the stations and the system is leased from the manufacturer, pest professionals who own Trelona ATBS would experience greater freedom and control to maintain their customer relationships exactly the way they want. You fully own these stations. You don't have to report any information back to BASF and are not required to pay fees to BASF to maintain your customers' accounts. So now I'll hand it over to Dr. Bob Davis to walk us through the technical portion for why Trelona ATBS is a trusted system with proven performance.
All right. Thank you, Antonia, and welcome everybody, and thank you for setting aside time today. And as Antonia mentioned, it is Valentine's Day, so all you guys out there, make sure you take care of your significant others. Today's the day, right? I'm glad you reminded me. I needed that, Antonia. Let's start with the stations, right? So one of the really nice advantages of the ATBS system is that our station design. You know, we have a low profile design, so that ensures that lawnmowers and kids running across the yard, they're not going to interact with the top of that station. It's not going to be a problem. But if you notice on the station design itself, we have a series of ribs. We've got vertical ribs, we've got horizontal ribs, and these kind of help it hold in place. So even those parts of the country where we have expansion, contraction soils, this keeps the stations in the ground at ground level where they're supposed to be, right? Also, those ribs, whether vertical or horizontal, as the termites are foraging and looking for new food sources, they're going to hit those ribs, and that brings them into those vertical slits, which allows them easy access into the station and then into the cartridges themselves. Notice we have two cartridges, and in those cartridges, we have what we call a pure cell matrix, right? It's a highly preferred cellulose feeding matrix that when the termites hit it, they say, hey, this is really good stuff, and they start feeding directly. And it really enhances their hits and their feeding because of the purified cellulose. With the two cartridges, we have a large bait load, meaning there's a lot of bait within each station to handle very large colonies, multiple colonies. So as you're going back maybe once a year, if that's what you'd like to do, this annual opportunity, you know there's a lot of bait that's around that structure to provide full-time control over that time span. The stations are made in the U.S. They're great. They're very durable. They're going to last a long time, very high quality. We have a locking cap that's easily accessible with our spider tool by the professional, but yet it's keeping kids and pets and you know, non-targets out of that station. And lastly, we have a newer active ingredient called Novaluron that takes less active ingredient to actually kill more termites, and it kills them faster than the difluvenzuron that we've had prior to that. So very exciting. Next slide, please, Antonia. So here's a study that was actually done by the University of Delaware, and their graduate student set up a system of replicates where he had active termite colonies in the center, and that's the red dot. And then he kind of drew a line, a circle, right, a half a meter away. And on that circle, he randomly placed an ATBS station and then a competitive station. So the way this is set up is the termites in the center have an equal chance to hit either station or both as they're foraging and looking for food. And as I said, they replicated this 20 times, and they looked at this data through 46 days. So let me show you what we got. Next slide, please, Antonia. So on the left-hand side, that's our ATBS station. And I want you to notice that of those 20 setups, right, 50% of those stations were found within 8 days of the commencement of this study, right? And then 85% were found within 33 days. So the termites were foraging, looking for food, and you can see, you know, finding them pretty directly. The competitive station, within 46 days, 50% of those stations were found, right? And then we did not see an increase in that beyond that time frame. So definitely a difference with station design and how it's set up and how the termites forage and find. So what does that mean? Well, if we're going to get faster hits, that means the termites foraging have a quicker opportunity to get a bait active ingredient into the colony, and that can allow for quicker control, stopping the damage, taking care of the termites that much faster. So station design does make a big difference. Next slide, please. The active ingredient. So Novaluron is the active ingredient in our ATBS. And for those of our customers who have been using ATBS for many years, you'll remember, you know, difluvenzuron was our active ingredient prior to this. Well, Novaluron, it's a benzylphenylurea. It works mode of action very similarly. However, it works much faster than the difluvenzuron. So we're going to get that quicker kill, quicker colony control with the Novaluron. Also, it takes less active ingredient to kill more termites versus the difluvenzuron. So we're getting more killing power per cartridge. So in those areas with a lot of pressure, a lot of colonies and large colonies, we have a lot more killing power per cartridge for that property, which gives for better control. Next slide, please. So Novaluron, as I mentioned, it's an insect growth regulator, and it works by the inhibition of chitin. So chitin is a protein that's the building block of the exoskeleton of the termites. So the worker class, especially within the termite colony, they're immatures, right? So every time they go to the next instar, they're going to go through the molting process, the metamorphosis. And when they do that, they actually shed their exoskeleton and they form a new one. Well, the main building block of that exoskeleton, again, is chitin. So when those termites, those workers, have been foraging and feeding and food trophallaxis, sharing the active ingredient with the other workers and other individuals in the colony, when they molt, that novaluron that's in their system is going to make them molt incorrectly. The chitin is not going to be formed the way it should be. And that could lead to death right at that time, or they're going to be malformed to the point their behaviors are wrong and they're going to die after that. So what happens in the immatures, especially the workers in the colony, they're gone through the access to the bait and the efficacy that the active ingredient has on those workers. And then the soldiers can't be fed, the reproductives aren't taken care of, the eggs aren't taken care of, and the colony collapses. So that leads to colony control. And it's all because this active ingredient is messing up how they synthesize, transport, and use the chitin in the formation of this exoskeleton. Next slide, please. So we've done a lot of studies here, and I'm going to share with you a couple of them today. And certainly we have other information that we're going to share with you, some websites and stuff. You can look at the collateral that we have available for you to take a look at and use with your customers. But here's a study we did with Texas A&M down at Rockport, Texas. And this is prior to Hurricane Harvey. You'll probably recognize the name, but that's where they hit landfall, right? But this is done before that. And we actually had a series of trees. We had 12 different trees, and they were either infested with native subterranean termites or coploptermes, formosanus, the Formosan termite. And four of those trees, we put five stations around each one, a half a meter away, and then let the termites forage in the stations, and they could hit the Trelona. And then we saw the impacts on the termite colony from there. And then another four trees, we did the same thing, ATBS stations, but we also did Termidor dry injections into the active sites on the tree where we could find the termites. And then we had another four trees that we did not treat. That was just our untreated controls we could do for comparison. And we checked these stations about every 4 months through 24 years post-installation and treatment to see the efficacy. So next slide, if you would. So you notice we had an install time, and we waited about 3 months, and then we came in and actually put the Trelona bait cartridges in the stations at that point that allowed them time to forage and find the stations. And then they did the Termidor treatment, and that's the 0 days at treatment, right? Then we went back and inspected basically every 4 months, and then through 24 months after treatment, noticed that after that initial treatment time, we had no activity in the stations, no activity in the trees through that 24 months, except for those that were untreated controls. That one untreated control at 16 months, we had fire ants moving, and we couldn't find termites at one inspection in one tree, but they popped back up a little bit later. But the point is here, the Trelona ATBS alone, Trelona ATBS with the Termidor dry, provided excellent efficacy to control these termites, knock out those termites, and then protect the trees also. Next slide, please. Well, we have to prove to ourselves, we have to prove to the EPA, and we have to prove to the pest management professional industry that, hey, this annual inspection interval is a good thing and will protect structures, because that's the name of the game. We're protecting your customer structures as part of the service, and that's what we're shooting for. So to prove that, we actually worked with the EPA and asked them, okay, what kind of data package would you like to see that would allow for you to possibly approve an inspection interval of once a year? And they asked us to go out and find termite-infested structures across many different states, and you can see here we had 10 different states, the termite belt, California, Ohio, New Jersey, and we went and found 50 different termite-infested structures. They were homes. And 12 of these were actually Formosan termite infestations down in Louisiana and Texas, and one in Florida. And then put the bait in the ground, and it was only in bait, in ground type treatments. So we did not do any on structure treatments or anything else. It was only the bait system in the ground that was tested. Went ahead and did it according to the label, we'll go through here in a second. And then we inspected those and did not change any bait cartridges, but looked at the 12-month inspection. So the data we gathered at 12 months post-feeding on the cartridges was no activity in the structures, no post-feeding treatment swarms in the structures, feeding in the stations, and then the stations were inactive at the 12 months. So the colonies are controlled, colonies are gone, the houses are taken care of. And this is the data that we then submitted to the EPA for use for the new label. All these 50 sites were found and treated by pest management professionals with us BASF researchers on site with them, along with university cooperators and or private researchers. We had third party people helping us gather this data for submission to the EPA and then submission to the states beyond that too. Next slide, please. So as a consequence of that, the EPA did review all the data and now approved, and we have this new label today that we're introducing to you folks today called Trelona ATBS Annual Bait Stations, right? So the opportunity now is that you could use this label to go ahead and put the stations around the structure and then go back, if you wish, once per year as your minimum. You can always go more than the minimum, that's fine, but this would be the minimum you'd have to go. Now, to make that happen, and I'll say this a couple times today, all the stations associated with that structure or that area you're treating, that structure, they have to have two 124-gram cartridges of the Trelona bait per station, right? So if that's done and all the stations have this set up, then you have the opportunity, if you wish, to go back once per year as your inspection protocol. You could always go more, but that could be your minimum. So these labels are available. In fact, all of our labels are available from BASF at this place called cdms.net. And you click on BASF Specialty and Professional Specialty Solutions, I believe it says. And then you go to labels, and you can get the SDS, all that kind of stuff too. So you can do that now, you can do it later. They're certainly available for you as reference. Next slide, please. So I know right now I'm speaking to a lot of customers that have Trelona today. They're using Trelona compressed termite bait. They can be doing direct baiting, as Antonia was referring to earlier in the talk, or maybe you're doing monitoring and then you put the Trelona bait in when you get the hit, and that's fine. If you want to convert your customers that are out there today to this annual opportunity, and you have this older bait that you've purchased, right, then on that cdms.net, you can also print off the supplemental label. So if your technician has the supplemental label with them and you have the older Trelona compressed termite bait labeled product, if you have both of those with you, then you can go ahead and make sure that all the stations have two 124-gram cartridges in each station, and you can begin to enjoy this annual bait interval, inspection interval right now. You can do that directly with the supplemental label before the new product labels come out. Or you have them in stock at your store, I should say, at your office. Next one, please. Okay, so let's actually take a few moments and kind of step through some of the highlights of the label, but please go ahead and get a specimen label from CDMS, and you could have that for direct comparison later on. Next slide, please. Okay, so here's the front page. Trelona ATBS, it will say annual bait stations at the top, and that differentiates from the label prior to that. It's Novaluron, 0.5%. There's a half a gram of Novaluron per 100 grams of formulation. It's a signal word caution. I know many of you folks have software packages where you list your registration numbers in your software packages, and that way it's printed off on your service tickets, invoices, your paperwork, or your digital forms. I just want to point out this is the same registration number as before. So you don't have to create a new product, new registration number. If you've been using Trelona prior, you're ready to go with this registration number. Next slide, please. Okay, just a couple things to point out. These are containerized, ready-to-use cartridges. They're set up and ready to go. You're not going to be handling the cartridges, you know, the actual matrix directly, that kind of stuff. But a couple things to call out. When you're done servicing stations, go ahead and wash up thoroughly. Soap and water, especially before eating, using the toilet, that kind of stuff too. Basically, the main environmental hazard is, you know, there are aquatic invertebrates that also have chitin. So anytime you're using a chitin synthesis inhibitor, try not to put stations in a place where possibly that could wash into an area where you have aquatic invertebrates. So keep it in areas where you're away from aquatic life and will be in great shape. Next slide, please. Okay, so another thing to point out, there's a phone number on the front of the label. If you got any questions, please give us a call. Let us know how we can be of service. But we do want to point out that the Trelona compressed bait can only be used in our ATBS stations, in our approved stations, right? So, you know, sometimes we try to be a little creative. We don't want to do that. Go ahead and just use the stations that we provide and make sure the baits are met. Also, very important statement, when used according to label, and we'll go through this label in a little bit more detail, this system will provide ongoing structural protection and it will be provided through colony elimination. So follow the label and we expect you to get really good results protecting your customer structures. Next slide, please. Okay, let's talk about installation, right? So many of you have a lot of bait experience and you know what I'm talking about. Some of you are kind of new to this baiting opportunity, and there's a couple things I want to point out. One of the questions we'll get is, well, okay, what's the spacing requirements, right? Well, we have on the label, we have open ground, like you're seeing here on the pictures here, that you don't want to go more than 20 feet between stations, okay? However, when you put stations out, it isn't just your spacing requirements, right? It's also you want to put stations where you have good coverage. You're also at areas of known activity, probable activity, conducive conditions, so wood to soil contact. Make sure you put stations in areas that make sense to give you the best protection for that structure. I usually find when I follow that type of procedure that if I'm averaging around, you know, 12, 13, 14, 15 feet between stations, you know, that's usually pretty good coverage. But the label allows you up to 20 feet. Now, if you have a situation where you have a driveway, you have a hard surface, and you don't have 20 feet between that has open soil, but you got less than 30, so if you're between 20 and 30 feet, the label says, hey, if you got those hard surfaces, you can bracket it, you can jump to either side as long as it's less than 30 feet. If you have a large driveway, a lot of asphalt, a lot of concrete, and you've got a lot of footage there that doesn't have any open soil, then it's advisable to go ahead and create an access through that concrete, through that asphalt, and then put some stations below that, and I'll show you how that can be done here in a second. But our label does say anything longer than that, hey, it's advisable to core that concrete and then put some stations in those areas. Next slide, please. Okay, so one process that we can use is to go ahead and excavate the hole that's about the same size as the stations. And at the end of this talk, I'll show you some tools that can be used for that. And then you'll notice on that, if you look at the slide or the picture on that picture on the far left, right, I just augered that hole. I'm getting ready to put the station in the ground. Notice how it's kind of mounted there. I like to move that dirt so you don't have that mounding, and then I'll go ahead and put the station down and then, you know, step on it, push down so we have really good close interface between the bottom of that station and the top of the surface of that soil. But I don't want it sticking up where maybe a lawnmower might hit it or a child might trip on it or something like that, right? So I like to kind of move that soil a little bit. But excavate the hole, put the station in there. You want it pretty tight because you want really good soil to station interface, so the foraging termites have a great chance to hit those ribs and then find their way into the station. Next slide, please. Okay, in this case, I'm actually showing some pictures here in Galveston, Texas, where we're coring down through that concrete, right? So in this case, I want to put the station below the concrete, but into the soil below the concrete. So I core a hole, and then we have a special concrete bait station. You see the picture of it there that you can get through distribution. And then that's a little bit narrower, right? That it fits through these cored holes that are standard to the universe, to the industry today. Go ahead and put that station into the soil below that. And then notice on the right-hand side, and many of you guys have seen these are those port covers that have a special screwdriver that make it tamper resistant. You can get these through distribution, and then those can be used to seal that cored hole at the top and then allow you future access to those stations. Okay, next one, please. And I kind of mentioned this earlier, right? It isn't just how far apart are my stations. You also want to make sure you put stations that are next to known active. You got a termite tube over there. Let's get it as close as possible, right? We know the termites are active in that area. With the best chance of them to get into the station. You got some conducive conditions, wood to soil contact, areas that just allow for better termite opportunities. Hey, let's put a station in that area, and I think that will help quite a bit. Next one, please. So we have some nice flexibility on the label if you have a crawl space type of foundation, right? So there are times where you can have a structure where the crawl space and then outside of a, I have zero lot lines and very little room to another person's property, or maybe a lot of concrete or a lot of parking spaces, asphalt, whatever. And there's really very little open access. Well, if I can get into the crawl space and it's decently accessible, I can instead put my stations inside the crawl space. It's just another option you have that may come in handy with different types of construction. Next slide, please. Okay, so another really nice call out on the label, and I've done this for many years, right? So if I get a hit or I have an area of the structure where there's just a lot of termite activity, and I want to maximize the potential of getting that bait load into the colony or colonies that much faster so I can get even quicker control, we might add a few stations, right? So we can put what we call supplemental stations around an area. Maybe I'll have two or three or whatever stations there to maximize the potential of getting that bait in that much faster. Now, once I get control, I've gone through a feeding cycle, the termites are gone, I'm not seeing activity in the area, you know, I can pull those supplemental stations and just leave the one station back in there for part of my coverage around the rest of that structure. So you have opportunities to increase that bait consumption even faster. Next slide, please. So the label's really broad also because it's available for both pre-construction as well as post-construction uses. Now, in Florida, there's a little bit of a call out because there are minimum standards. But go ahead and if you have pre-construction opportunities in other parts of the country, this is a great system for you. Now, it's you need to not place these in the ground until the final grade is established, and that's, you know, per label regulation. However, I think it's also preferable to kind of wait until most of the landscaping's kind of in, because if you put the things in the ground and they come back in and, you know, put mulch in and all this other stuff, it may be pretty difficult to locate and work those stations. So, but it can be used in pre-construction, new construction opportunities in those situations. Next slide, please. And definitely, it's a wonderful post-construction type of treatment. Now, one thing I want to point out, post-construction uses are supported when there's active termites, remedial treatment, if you will. Maybe the termites are infesting the structure, they're in the landscaping, they're around, you know, landscape timbers, whatever, they're close by. You can do that, but you can also do it just for preventative. You know, I don't want to have termites, therefore I love to have your ATBS Trelona system put around my structure, and let's intercept those termites before they become a problem. That's certainly an opportunity. Of course, if I have an infested structure today, we put in the ATBS Trelona, we knock them out through feeding, then it's going to become an ongoing preventative as time goes on. Next slide, please. Antonia kind of mentioned this earlier, right? She talked about direct baiting, and until this annual bait station label came available, many of our customers were going to do what we call direct baiting. And that basically means they were putting bait in the stations and leaving them there at all times. So as termites find the station, they can immediately start putting bait into the into the colony, and that allows for faster control. So it's a really good approach, right? Now, this is another form of direct baiting, if you will, but when you have annual bait station where you're going to come back once a year, then you have to have two cartridges in every station and all the stations around that structure, and they are direct baited, but you would have two to allow for once a year inspections. If you only have one in a station or whatever, you can do that. That's still called direct baiting, but you have to go back three times per year, and that would be the difference. Next slide, please. So once again, I'm just going to say it again, right? If you want to use this annual baiting opportunity once per year, every station around the structure needs to have two of these cartridges. If you have any other situation out there, I've got termite monitoring boards in some of them, I'm only doing one bait cartridge in a station or two, you can do that according to the label, but then you have to go back at least three times per year on your inspections. Next slide, please. Okay, and please check with your state regulations. If you have some minimum standards a little bit different, please follow those. This is a federal label. If your state is a little bit more restrictive in some things, you must follow the state, and we certainly know that too. Okay, next one, please. Another nice opportunity here. I'm actually in Lincoln, Nebraska today, and we have a pretty good snowfall this last couple of weeks or so, and we have decent snow out there. So if my annual bait station inspection date was to fall on today, I'd be moving 4 or 5 inches of snow to try to find the station. So that doesn't make sense. Termites aren't going to be foraging in the freezing snow. That's not, you know, they're cold-blooded insects, and that's how it's going to work. So the label allows for a little flexibility where if that's the case and you're hitting like this old man winter time, you can go out to 15 months prior to going out and checking that annual inspection, but not more than 15 months. That would be the maximum you could go out. Next slide, please. Okay, so let's talk about the procedure of inspecting these stations. Remember, if you're doing this annual bait station opportunity, that means you're gonna have 2 cartridges in each station. And notice in this picture here, I got a cotter key puller, a cotter pin puller that I use to kind of hook the cartridge. And that's a really nice way to lift it up. And some of you guys have other tools you like to use, and that's fine too. But the spider tool, you can see it on the lid. You use the spider tool, open the station, move the lid to the side, and right away I look in the station. Okay, am I seeing tubing? Am I seeing maybe activity, right? If they just hit it here recently. But a lot of times you can see tubing. If that happens, go ahead and hook that with your cotter key puller or lift that cartridge out and then take a look at that individual cartridge. If more than 1/3 of that bait cartridge has been fed upon, then we're going to go ahead and have that replaced with a new cartridge. The reason is you're going to be going another year possibly before you come back and inspect. We want to make sure there's plenty of bait there for that termite colony or more termites colonies are in the area that hit those stations. Well, there's another cartridge below that. We're going to hook that one, lift it up, inspect it. Same question. Is more than 1/3 of it gone? If so, we're going to replace that. If not, put it back in, reseal that station lid, and then go on to the next station and continue the process. We also point out, and Antonia kind of talked about this at the beginning too, and she's going through that cost per year and talking about replacement cartridges and stuff. Well, if we have more than 1/3 feeding, then you're going to have to replace the cartridge, right? So make sure there's plenty of bait out there for the termites to feed upon. So that would be a reason to replace the cartridge. If you have an extremely nasty cartridge, I mean like 100% slimy mold, that kind of stuff, then we're recommending you go ahead and replace that cartridge. But we're finding that these cartridges can be lasting for 2, 3, 4, 5 years or even more. And unless it gets that really 100% slimy, hey, they like some mold, they like mildew, they like fungus, and a lot of that just helps bring them in so they get even better feeding if the termites are in the area. So leave those in there, and that's going to reduce your cost of goods over time. But we're finding these stations will last, you know, multiple years, and we're suggesting at this point in the data we're seeing that over about a 5-year time frame, you're probably going to be replacing most, if not all of them. But hey, 5 years looking pretty good for many of these cartridges. Next slide, please. Okay, so we have a lot of customers out there right now that have ATBS in the ground. We got Trelona in the ground and just haven't been able to do this annual bait station approach. So how can you transition your present customers to this, right? So if you want to go to the annual, then what you need to do is go back out when you do your next inspection, go on out to the site, go to each one of the stations, and then by the time you leave that site, every station has to have 2 cartridges, right, of Trelona bait that do not have more than 1/3 of it fed upon. So you open up a station, let's say you had direct baiting with 1 bait cartridge and termite monitoring boards below that. You pull out the termite monitoring boards, put a new cartridge in where they were, look at your other cartridge, and if it doesn't have more than 1/3 feeding, hey, it's ready to go. Put it back in, you're ready to go. If it has more than 1/3 of it gone from feeding, replace that with a new cartridge, close that station, go to the next one, repeat the process. So if you want to convert ones you already have in the ground to once a year inspections, go out and make sure that each station has the 2 cartridges and that all of them have at least, you know, no more than 1/3 of the bait fed upon by the termite prior. So hope that's helpful. Next one, please. Okay, so like I said, the interval, transitioning to this, if you have anything else except 2 124-gram bait cartridges in there, that's fine, but you're going to have to schedule to go back 3 times per year. You want the annual, then have those 2 cartridges in every one of the stations. Next, please. So we have, you know, when you get the label, you can read it and see a lot of these opportunities, but we have other flexible options too. One of them is we have some spot treatment opportunities. So this is not a, you know, I'm going to protect your structure through a spot treatment. That's not the point, right? but we showed trees, we show, you know, wood piles, landscaping elements, railroad track beds, you know, where you have some activity, and the customer, hey, I want to knock out these termites that are around my fence, that kind of stuff, right? Well, that's an opportunity through a spot treatment with these stations. You can add one, two, whatever it is in that area. And if in those stations you have two 124 gram cartridge opportunities, you can go back and look at those once per year if you wish. And of course, when you're done, you go ahead and pull them and go from there. So it's not really a building protection, structural protection claim. It is a spot treatment area to kill a whole bunch of termites that are affecting trees or wood piles, whatever it might be. Next slide, please. So they can be made alone, just the bait stations. You'll get feeding, you can kill a lot of termites, knock out some colonies in that area, or you can do it in a combination. Maybe there's an area you want to put that Trelona dry in the landscaping timbers, and then you want to go ahead and put the ATBS Trelona stations with it. You can do that too, right? It's kind of a non-structural thing where they both can be put together. But once again, if you want the annual opportunity, two cartridges per station. Next, please. Like I said, the inspection schedule will be based on whether you have the two cartridges in there or not. And if you do, you're set for once a year. Any other opportunity, three times per year. Okay, next slide, please. So this is a little different. This is supplemental treatments, right? And there's different scenarios here, and I'll let you look at the label and see all the different scenarios. But one of them might be where the main treatment is a terminal liquid treatment, and then on the backside of the building, this would be an area that's not associated with structures and buildings like trees and wood piles and landscaping elements. That's the picture we're showing here, so you can do tree treatments. But another supplemental treatment could be where you're treating three sides of the house with a nice terminal treatment. In the back side of the house, they got some fruit trees, and I'm going to put some ATBS stations there. And you could do that, as long as the labels speak to each other, which they do in this case. But if you want to come back once a year on those stations, go ahead and have two cartridges per station. You'll be set for once a year inspections. So read this part of the label, and you'll see there's different opportunities for supplemental treatments. Next slide, please. Okay, so that was a pretty quick overview of the label. And like I say, please go to cdms.net, print it off, take a look at it. If you have questions, let us know, and we'll walk through it with you. But that was a, you know, pretty quick, but actually pretty thorough on it. There's really a lot of flexibility there. So keys to success, if you would, with the next slide, we'll go through some of these ideas. This is a diagram that actually one of the 50 structures that we treated for the EPA data package. And, you know, one of the things for a key to success is to have a really good diagram, right? It's definitely want an outline of the structure. You want to have proper measurements, and I suggest having things to scale. That's good, too. I put down things like fence lines. I put down where stumps, trees, landscaping timbers. Certainly put down where there's termite activity, conducive conditions. And you want to note where the stations are. And, of course, number the stations in order. I like to go to the front of the door and then, you know, number one's to my right, I'm right-handed, and I go around that way. Then, you know, maybe you want to start at the fence where the gate is and then work around to the backside. So however you want to do it's fine. Wherever I put stations, I also like to kind of look at the structure and say, okay, I'm going to put it right off the edge of the window or maybe off the spigot to the side or whatever. So when I come back, it's hard to find it for some reason, I have an idea of where I put it. And the diagram can really help with a lot of this too, having a good diagram showing a really good facsimile of the site and where you put the stations can be very, very helpful. Next one, please. So here's some of the tools that I use when it comes to installation, right? So I have both a power auger. I also have this hand auger you can see in the picture. I like the, you know, not promoting any type of auger or whatever, but I do have the echo drill that I like, and I like to have it with reverse option. So if I'm augering down the soil and I hit a tree root and it kind of jams, I can put it in reverse and I can back it out, right? So those things can be helpful. That manual one you can see there, I actually have a 360 ratchet on top, and that's really very, very helpful. If you have a technician that's doing a lot of service and not putting in a ton of stations all the time, but they're servicing stations, then this is somewhat less expensive option that they can put in stations, do quite well, but not have to have a power auger. Those things can be quite helpful. Now, all this stuff is available to our distribution partners. Please contact them. They can help you. If you'd like to look at a catalog, this one on the screen, this ams-samplers.com, they have a really good section on termite baiting. You can take a look at the tools they have listed there. Next slide, please. So this is tools that I like to use for inspections, right? So they're already installed and going back to inspect over time. You can see this bottom picture on the left, gentleman's using this clean out auger. Sometimes you lift these cartridges out, you know, loose sand and soil or whatever can fall back in. It's hard to get the cartridges in every time. So you might want to clean it out. I use you can see it in that top picture in the middle row, second from the left. I use that melon baller. I get that at Target, and it's a really, you know, heavy duty melon baller, and I can really dig those out quite quickly. It's just a really helpful tool. I mentioned the cotter key puller for lifting out the stations. That helps. That spider tool is up there, and that's the distribution you can use to open the lids. I have to carry a bucket with me or something that I can put the old cartridges in as I'm servicing the stations. That will help in carrying new ones with me. The Sharpie is great for numbering these stations and keeping those in order. And if I add a supplement or whatever, supplemental station, I can number that too and keep all that going. So all these tools are helpful at times. And I'm sure many of you out there that have baiting experience, you have some great tools you like to use also. Next slide, please. So when you do need to core a hole through maybe concrete or asphalt or a hard surface, right, there are some tools available. Distribution can help with that, and that AMS-samplers has these too. You can use these concrete boring bits, okay, and you can rent these too from various local rental places. Once you core that hole, you can see number two, that's the picture of our concrete bait station. This has a monitor in it, but for the annual bait stations, you go ahead and put two bait cartridges in that, and you, after you've cored the hole, you take the regular soil auger down through that cored hole, excavate a hole in the soil, place this concrete bait station, which you can get through distribution, into that soil, then you close it again with that port cover like we're showing here. So, and those are all available distribution, but it's a great way to get good coverage, and I've had, you know, excellent control through the years by using this approach too. Next slide, please. So the question we're going to get, and I'm sure some of you have probably already typed it in, is do you have an above ground station? And the answer is we have not developed one and brought it to the market. And the reason is because we have some really, really good supplemental treatment options with our portables, right? So we got Termidor Dry, Termidor Foam, Termiticide, Insecticide. We have our dilutables. We do direct injections with the HE, the SC, WG. And we also have the Alpine Foam in a can too. That's a great opportunity because, and these, you know, in this case, we've got the ATBS Trelona in-ground stations protecting the structure, forging termites, pick up the bait. We work on the colonies that way through their transfer process of the trophallaxis of the active ingredients. But these here, then, we can go to that damaged wood, those shelter tubes, the wood to soil contact with the active, and we can do direct injection with the Termidor Dry or allow the foam expansion to go in there where the termites are, and they can use their transfer process to transfer these materials. So I'm a great believer in treating those areas that are active on the structure because it enhances that control, but we can use the transfer process with these portables along with the ATBS Trelona annual bait stations in the ground. They just get fantastic remedial control on the front end and prevention over time too. Next slide, please. So, okay. You see the animation going on here, but we kind of have a setup of a 240, 250 foot linear structure, and you want good coverage around as you put your stations in the ground. You know, you want to keep less than that 20 foot spacing, but, you know, think about conducive areas, think about conducive conditions, active areas, wood to soil contact. And I think you'll find out that 10 to 15 foot is probably where you're going to end up most of the time. Notice the driveway. We have a 30 foot bracket where we can find accessible soil on either side, and the label allows for that to occur. As long as you're 30 foot or less. If it's greater than that, it's advisable to, you know, cut a hole and use a concrete bait station below that. That's an opportunity for you too. When you put your stations around the structure, sometimes the guttering systems may not be there and there's a drip line coming off the structure. I suggest keeping the station not underneath the drip line where it can be washed out a little bit. You know, maybe move it outside of that. You can move it inside. The only exception to that I would really call out is if you believe there was a repellent termiticide treatment at one time or something of that nature along the foundation, you know, we don't want to put a bait station within a repellency that doesn't allow the termites to forage into the station, right? So keeping away from the edge of the foundation is somewhat a good idea, unless you're really convinced and you know there's no treatment there in the past, right? Now, if you have activity right there along the foundation, that means that even if there was a termiticide there, it's not doing what it's supposed to. Let's put a station right there where that activity is. I think that's important too. Let's see. Termites are probably susceptible. Let's put some stations there. That can be very, very helpful. Next slide, please. Well, that's our stewardship slide. We just want to point out, hey, let's get the label. Let's follow it. Let's use it. Make sure you use it for the registered uses, and that's very helpful for stewarding the products. Next one, please. And just to kind of hear at the end, and we're going to have some questions, but I want to point out that you can go to TrelonaATBS.com. We got some frequently asked questions bulletins there. We got a bulletin about, you know, flooding, and, you know, there's different support pieces there that could help you with your customers, with your technicians, with training, but also when you're talking with your potential customers about the opportunity. Of course, we talked about CDMS.net, great opportunity there. PCT, many of you have probably seen some of the label training programs. We have a training program on Trelona and Trelona annual bait that's available. And Brad here can help us in a second about how to access that. Please do that. And of course, hey, talk to our distributors. They're there to help out and with all this information too, and our sales team too. We're out there to help. So with that, I'm going to turn it back over to Antonia and we'll go from there.
Thanks, Dr. Bob. Actually, we're all done, so I'm going to pass it back to Brad, and let's see what kind of questions that we have for the remainder of the time. Thank you, Dr. Bob.
Thanks, Antonia and Dr. Bob. We did get some questions come in, and we'll continue to field them throughout the Q&A. The first one we had was wondering about what is the projected lifespan of the Trelona cartridges?
Yeah, thanks, Brad. And that's a great question. I kind of addressed it a little bit in the talk, but it's a prime question because it really helps you estimate your cost of goods going forward and what your expectations are, right? And a couple things come into play. I mean, first one is, how active is the site? Do you have some large colonies, a lot of termites? Are you getting a lot of feeding? Because if you get a lot of feeding, then we're going to go ahead and replace those cartridges as they're being fed upon, right? So some of this is going to be driven by how much pressure there is on that property. Okay, the other side of the coin is environmental conditions, right? So fungus, mold, mildew, slimy stuff, all that kind of things that can, you know, over time lead to some forms of degradation of the cartridge. What does that do for impacting how often you put them in? Well, what we're seeing in all of our field work that we've been doing around the country, right, is these cartridges are having some pretty good longevity. I basically kind of replace them when it comes to, you know, not the feeding stuff. I replace them when we get the feeding. But for all the other stuff, I'm replacing them when I just got, it's just slammed slimy mold, okay? When I get to that point, yeah, I'm going to go ahead and replace it. But anything kind of less than that, you know, fungus and mold and mildew, even looking pretty nasty, but they're not totally slammed or I think the cellulose is degraded down. That active ingredient's there, the termites are feeding upon it in many cases. I mean, it's still in good shape. So it kind of depends on your environment and where you're at. It depends on how much feeding you're at. I think a good rule of thumb is kind of what Antonia had on her model, which was once you get to that 5 or 6 years past install, you're probably going to have replaced most of those cartridges, if not all, right? But hey, going 5, 6 years, that's pretty good shape.
Next question we had was, would you comment on the termite baiting and its effectiveness on different species?
Oh, yeah, fantastic. If you kind of remember back to that slide where I showed the data package that the EPA asked us to put together, which was those 50 different sites. And, of course, we had 12 of those were coptotermes, you know, the formosans here in the United States. And then the other ones we had, you know, reticulotermes, but even there we had the eastern subs, and I think we had some virginicas and probably some hagenii too. So we do see where for subterranean termite species we're getting great efficacy. Now this is not a dry wood termite or even a damp wood termite type of system, so we don't have data on that. Of course, this is for soil borne ones, but we're getting excellent efficacy across that. And Phoenix too, we have data out of Phoenix with the heterotermes, which is another one we get questions about, which is a a great question. Thank you.
We had a couple of people ask questions about getting a recording of the webinar, and yeah, we are recording the webinar, and we'll make it available to BASF. So just check in with your local BASF rep, and they can get it for you. Question one here was, next question we had was, do you still have to treat bass traps?
Great question. The label does not require you to treat bass traps with the ATBS Trelona. It is an option. Anytime you have an access, interior or exterior, you can go ahead and use a station in that area. Do I think it's important to inspect bass traps when you can? You bet. Termites forage, they hit pipes, they follow them into the structure. So checking bass traps, and if you have activity in there, you can definitely do the ATBS in the bat trap. You could do a supplement with a Termidor. The labels allow you different options.
And you did you sort of answered the next question with your discussion there, Dr. Bob. But if the house has active termites, do you need to do a liquid treatment, or is a bait station good enough? Bait station only good enough?
Yeah, that's a great question, and the answer to all of the above is yes. Right, so. You have all those options. If you have a site where, yeah, I love this baiting system approach, it's going to be fantastic, but I also want you to go ahead and do a little directed treatment here with some, and you could use Termidor foam or dry or whatever to take care of those, you know, more immediately, you can blend both of these together as an approach, right? But if you have a place that, hey, we want the ATBS Trelona, we want it in the ground, we're going to let those termites have time to find them, then we're going to knock them out that way, then that's the approach you can do. The 50 sites that we went through, that's what we did, right? Well, there was no above ground treatments of any sort with any of those 50 sites. So the data we gathered there was ATBS in ground only. So I think all the above can work. It's flexible for how you want to do your protocol with the customer and what that customer would like you to do. So you can, you know, build your protocol the way you want it.
The next question we had was, besides station design, what other factors make the system attractive for foraging termites, such as an attractant?
Yeah, you know, that's a really great question. And if you look through the literature for many, many years about termite feeding, foraging, and of course baiting, there's a lot of questions about that, right? So they don't really randomly forage. Termites don't randomly forage, but they do have a system in place in the ground where they go off at certain angles, which gives them the best chance of finding a food source, right? And then once they find a food source or a guideline, they follow that, like pipes into a bath trap or whatever, or following landscape timbers. Well, one of those guidelines, of course, as we mentioned, could be those ribs on the stations. So that helps them feed them in. And then I mentioned, too, another part of this is the actual bait itself is a purified cellulose. It doesn't have any terpenes in it or anything that is detractive to the termites where they're not going to want to feed upon it, right? And it's really easy to give, you know, these termites human characteristics and say they're going to decide to feed upon something or whatever, right? But that's not what they do. But when they hit a food source and it's sampled and it's a high quality food source, then they use their pheromone chemistry to bring in other workers to then feed upon that. So between station design, the amount of cellulose that's available and the quality of the cellulose that's available, that could maximize that potential for those termites to then bring other workers in and say, this is our food source, let's bring it into the colony. So all those things together, plus an active ingredient that allows them to transfer it back in and use their behavior to transfer it within the colony, all that leads to, I think, answering that question about what are all the factors that help bring that active ingredient in the colony and then provide that control. There's quite a bit going on there.
Next question we had was, how can you locate the stations? The comment was, with checking yearly, customers will often cover these devices with mulch and so forth.
Yeah, great question. And of course, you know, they'll do it whether you're going back three times a year, right? So it does happen. There's some tricks to the trade. I think having a great diagram is a place to start. And I kind of mentioned this in my talk too, but when I'm putting stations out, before I just put a hole in the ground and put that in there and say, this is where I think I want it, I kind of look at the structure and I say, okay, if I move it over 3 inches, I come off the edge of a weep hole or I come off the edge of a windowsill. I use structural guidelines to help me position it, right? So then if I do come back at X amount of time later and they have done a new landscaping and there's mulch over it, I have a really good idea of where to kind of probe with a screwdriver or my probing tool to find that station. I know lots of companies that will put a metal washer in the top, right? They can use that with a metal detector. That's an option too. So there's different tricks of the trade. I think number one, it's having a system, training your techs with the system to help put it in places you think it would have been then when you had to look for it. And then educating your customers, letting them know, hey, this is what we're doing. You know, make sure you keep these termite stations top of mind when you're doing any kind of new additions or landscaping, and that will help too. But those are some ideas.
A question we have was, do you have to use the concrete stations when coating, or can you simply put the two baits in the cores hole and put the cap on?
Oh, that's a great question. I would suggest the label, since it mentions stations, yeah, you need to go ahead and put that CBS station, the concrete bait station, in the ground and not just use an open hole, because the label's talking about putting the cartridges in a station.
A question we had was, how do we dispose of the cartridges that have been fed on more than one third?
Yeah, thanks for that. And like I say, please get a hold of the label because there's much more information on there. We just have time to go through it. But for disposal of used cartridges, if you still have some bait in there, but it's been fed upon and you need to replace it, you can go ahead and wrap that in newspaper and just put it in the sanitary for the landfill. If it's totally empty, I mean, the termites have just creamed it, you know, and that'll happen every now and then, you can actually offer that plastic for recycling. That's an opportunity too. But if you don't want to do that, go ahead and wrap it in paper, put it in the landfill. So those directions are all covered in the label, but that's what you do.
A question we had was, are you limited in how far away from the foundation you can go?
Yeah, and that's a great question. I'm getting that a number of times, and there really is no setback requirements from the foundation, either being too far or too close, other than, you know, we don't want it so close to the foundation if there might have been a liquid termiticide treatment that's repellent or something like that, right? But no, we don't have something that says, you know, if you're more than 10 feet away from the foundation, that you're off label. That's not on the label.
Question we had was, what size auger bit is recommended, 2.5 inches or 3 inches?
Yeah, so the when you go to that AMS or work the distribution, right, they'll show you some different bits that work for the ATBS station, and that 2.5 to 2.625 inch bit will work just fine. The station itself kind of tapers down a little bit at the bottom, and when you put that in, that will really give you really good tight soil contact, right? If you have one of the other coring bits that's a little bit smaller, and that's what you have, you can use that. It's just you're going to have to kind of rotate it around a little bit to ream it out a little bit as you put it in, right? But I would use that 2.5 to 2.625. The other thing I would do is, as you're drilling your hole, I would go a little bit deeper than the station, maybe like an inch and a half. And what that will do is, if you have irrigation or, you know, heavy irrigation or rains or whatever, it kind of acts like a sump and it lets the water kind of drain through a little bit. Because, you know, termites can't breathe in areas that are 100% water, right? So that's pretty tough. So you kind of want that to drain a little bit. That's another thing I'd do with that auger bit.
A question we had was, what is the actual diameter of the station and the hole size?
Yeah, so use that 2.5, 2.625 inch will work well. If you measure the top, I believe it's 4 inches. You measure the bottom down there, I think it's 2.625. I think it's exactly. It depends if you measure the ribs and that kind of stuff. But yeah, that's the auger bit I would use.
The question was, do you sell the orange spider? The comment was, the metal ones can be hard to use.
What we have is those aluminum alloy type spiders. We used to have an orange one that was kind of the ergonomic one. And customers, they like the metal ones. So we went ahead and just kept the metal ones. We just have the one that's optional now.
Question was, would it be beneficial to move the untouched cartridge, if any, to the bottom and placing the new one on top?
Yeah, that's a good question. You certainly could. If you had I like that idea. I mean, you certainly can, and I've done that a couple times, but I think sometimes you have an age station versus an age cartridge versus a non-age cartridge, and if that's where your activity was and that's the, you know, the areas are kind of more active, I think that's a good idea. You certainly can do that.
Question is it possible to do a supplemental Terminator HE treatment around a residential structure along with the Trelona ATBS system?
Yeah, the labels will speak to each other, right? So it depends on which one is the primary service that's providing the structural protection, right? So if HE is your primary and you're doing like an EPLI or more, that's fine. But let's say on the back side of the house, you have a peach tree and it's got peaches that the folks like to harvest, and it's, you know, the drip lines over that foundation line. Okay. So, well, the label, you want to keep that HE out of there, but you can go ahead and do the ATBS in that area. So the ATBS then would be supplemental to the HE. The other, it might be the other way around, where three sides of the house, you got ATBS, and on the back side, there's, you know, quite a bit of activity or whatever. And the customer and you guys decide, okay, I want to go ahead and do HE in that area, trench and treat, and get that done. You could do that where the HE is now supplemental to the ATBS. So, you know, you have some, a lot of flexibility there.
And Dr. Bowdy, you had mentioned a little bit about label training. If I can mention real quick, PCT training, online training program. There are two ways you can access our online training program, our label training program, from our website, which is training.pctonline.com, or also from Univar's online pro training platform. If you haven't tried the courses yet, I would encourage you to. About 2 weeks ago, we just added the two from BASF, the cilantro rodent bait module and the Trelona ATBS module. Again, they were created by Stoy Hedges, and what Stoy did is he really kind of broke the labels down into small manageable segments, so you sort of learn as you go. The courses also use photographs, video clips, and reference materials to give you a real comprehensive experience. And the other component that I'll mention to it is it's accessible by PC, tablet, or smartphones, and the modules are designed to take a half hour to an hour to complete. And we feel that the brevity gives individuals the opportunity to fit the education in whenever their schedule allows. It could even be during breaks or lunchtime. So again, it's a free service from PCT, and I would encourage you to check it out at training.pctonline.com. And also can be accessible through the Univar online pro training platform. So we did get a couple more questions in here we'll go through. And that was, do you need to install auxiliary stations around active stations?
You can. As we went through that, we use the word supplemental on the label instead of auxiliary. But if you want to put some extra stations in an area because of enhanced activity and you want to speed up the control opportunities, you certainly can.
The question was, if you have active termites in a home, can you still wait a year to go back and check the annual station, or should you go back a couple times?
Well, the label allows you to wait. I think it's wonderful service to set up with your customer to say, I will be back in X amount of time to inspect the stations is certainly the active site in the structure. And I think that's a great approach to have your customer. But the label gives you flexibility, right? So you do have some options.
Okay. All right, Dr. Bob and Antonia, we did get through all the questions, I believe. If there are any that I missed, I apologize for that, or if there's any that may come to you after the fact, I encourage you to reach out to your BASF rep, or you could also contact Dr. Bob and Antonia directly via phone or via email. So before we wrap things up, I just want to again thank everyone for joining us for the webinar today. And Antonia and Dr. Bob, do you have any final comments you'd like to make?
I'll just start and turn it over to Antonia, but I want to thank everybody for their time today and have a fantastic week. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Brad, and thank you, everybody, for attending. Again, we have lots of resources available along with this recording, but please visit our website and talk to your distributor to get product today. Thank you.
All right. Thanks again, everybody, for taking some time out of your schedule to attend our webinar today. Have a great day.